what some would call history in the making.
Don't say that.
We have never been down 1,000 points ever, not even intraday on the NASDAQ.
Is that true?
That is true.
Okay. Down 6% right from the get-go. This is heavy, heavy, big tech. Here we go. Look at them go down. Microsoft is down 20 bucks. That's 5%. Alphabet, 5%. Meta, 6%.
You're all
Amazon,
going to die. That's what's going
Apple,
to happen.
9% down. Let's pull out Apple.
That's Barney, Stuart Barney. I like his manner of speaking there. You're all going to die is what's going to happen. You know, the economy's going to Hades in a handbasket. That's what's happening right now. Back to you. I like Stuart Varney, so don't snitch on me. We get along. He's great. I just like his. He's so. It's just very nice to have such a polite way of telling us we're all gonna, you know, it's all gonna crash and burn. It's super nice, isn't it, Kane? I mean, I know that I love to have, you know, those kind of vibes when I'm gonna need more coffee. I'm gonna need some like whiskey in it to get you guys started today. I'm really sorry about that, but it is. It's Monday. Hi guys. All right, so I'm sure you've seen some things with the economy today. It's not going so great. Why are you laughing? I'm going to ease everybody into this. This is not right to be doing this to these people today. First off, welcome, friends. Welcome. Go ahead and pull up a beanbag chair on the sharing circle. Dana Loesch with you. Top of this first hour on Monday, right? If you know the little TikTok videos, I'm not on TikTok, but I can't escape them, that you see, because Zoomer culture is we're going to repeat things like it's a cult chant repeatedly, and we're going to repeat it into the camera, and then they like say it over and over again, and like, what was it, like Gen Z slay in a hoop and all this other stuff. So the news cycle is market crash and dead bear cub, market crash and dead bear cub. That's what we're looking at today. Yeah, you're welcome. I'm going to get to the dead bear cub. So the program you can watch everywhere. Rumble's where the discussion is. X everywhere. I'm not going to sit here. If you're watching, you know how. But Dana Loesch with you. So the economy, it's Kamalanomics, which is so much more fun to say than Bidenomics. So can we change this? Kamalanomics, Kane. Is where we're looking at. U.S. stocks open lower. Global markets plunged overnight. And the consumer boom, if ever there was one, is now beginning to falter, say the headlines. That's where it all is. It's it's not doing so well. Everyone's saying, is it a recession? Are you asking that? Like, are people actually asking if it's a recession? Because it is. Right? I mean, that's... You should need to ask because that's where we're at right now. So that's where we are. That's where we are. Bad times. We're in that, you know, that meme that goes around that says good times create weak men. Weak men create hard times. Hard times create strong men. Strong men create good times. Good times create weak men. Okay, we're in the weak men are creating hard times right now. This is where we're at. That's out of all of that. That's where we're standing right now. So. The economy, if you've been following it all, you know, not great. And we're getting ready to go into an election. Well, we're in an election cycle. We're getting ready to, you know, I mean, it's wild to see because when we came out of the pandemic, that we were taking some steps to kind of reclaim some of the strength there as it pertained to the economy. And now, I mean, this is just, nobody can buy a house. Everything, butter's $7 or eggs are, it's crazy. It's crazy. And this is the fact that you have an MIA president. I don't even know what his schedule is today. And the Associated Press came out. This is all timed perfectly. Kamalanomics. The senior economics aides leaving the White House. He's going to be leaving the White House because it's more important for him to work on the Harris campaign. So he's going to go work on the Harris campaign, leaving the White House. That shouldn't be a surprise to anyone. So it is, there you go. I mean, you got the crypto collapse. You're looking at recession. The stock market's a mess. Japanese stocks were just crashing. Biggest one-day drop since 1987. Biggest daily loss since 1987, worldwide fears of a U.S. economic slowdown. And everyone's like, oh my gosh, it seems like a crash. It's like a crash. And you're, I don't know. The messaging for Republicans seems like it should be super easy right now. But, you know, this is Republicans to lose. And they will. They'll do everything in their stupidity to do it. I mean, nobody's exempt from that. Nobody, including anyone's, you know, number one icon. It's all theirs to lose. So this should, the messaging from now, here and now on, should be about the economy. Economy, 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 economy. Because you had Kamala Harris just saying, when was this, like a week ago, that Bidenomics was working. They were proud of it. Yeah, it's Bidenomics was working. This was something that they were very, very proud of. Yeah, play this audio soundbite 17. They're very proud of this. Never forget this.
All that, ladies and gentlemen, and everyone else, that is called Bidenomics. That is called Bidenomics, and we are very proud of Bidenomics.
She had said, Bidenomics is working. And honestly, this is something that Republicans, this should be an ad. That should be an ad. They should be absolutely everywhere. They should be outside, and Republicans should be outside in the front of grocery stores. And they should be playing that on an iPad for everybody walking into the grocery store over and over again on loop. Bidenomics is working. Bidenomics is working. They should be doing that. They should be purchasing ads on the digital surfaces and all the grocery stores and everything, tickers, everything. Bidenomics is working. That's what Kamala Harris said. And by the way, excuse me, that audio was from 1 year ago, but she actually said that to a reporter a month ago. The jobs report July that came out on Friday was so horrible. That's when you knew this was coming. You knew today was coming. The markets went into a full blown panic. And then, you know, with crypto, what did they said? How many trillions, Kane? It was $1.2 trillion were just vanished from the cryptocurrency market.
It's closer to two right now.
Past 24 hours. The fear index is the highest since 2020. Market panic reshapes political and policy outlook. And Bidenomics is working, though. That's what we were told. We were told that this was all going to be great. Oh, and you know whose the problem it is if it's not great. Right? You guys know who's to blame if it's not great. You know, but it's great, though. We're told it's great. But just in case it's not great, it's apparently Trump's fault. Not kidding. That's what they've been. Well, I told you this. We played a little bit of it Friday. But they're really, the Harris campaign is full on saying that it's all Trump's responsibility. He cost our economy millions of jobs when he wasn't president. I'm sorry, what? Yeah, because he hasn't been in office for a full term, right? So Kane, he's like super powerful. I mean, can you imagine like being blamed for stuff that you didn't do when you weren't in office? That's power. Imagine that. Like you are blamed for something you didn't do when you weren't even in that position. It's like me blaming Kane for the, you know, horrendous opening at the Olympic Games. It's all your fault, Kane.
I didn't do that.
What did you do? What did you do? You ruined the Olympics because you did that with the fat blue Smurf and all that, the chonky Smurf, and you did all of that stuff. You did it, but I wasn't in it. I know, but you know what? You did it. If this is going to be the new baseline, I am going to abuse this. I am at the point where I am in Absurdville right now. It's where I'm living. I'm going to be there. I'm going to stay here until November. So I'm just going to start blaming. If we can say, yeah, Trump is totally responsible for the things he didn't do when he wasn't in office. I mean, damn him. They said that he's brought us, I swear to you, her spokesperson, James Singer, went out with a straight face and said, he's bringing us to the brink of recession, Trump is. Kamala Harris, her spokesperson, said that Donald Trump is bringing us to the brink of recession. How? Am I missing something here?
Look, over the weekend, cut 14, Biden said he cured the economy. I don't understand how we're here today if Friday night he had the economy all cured.
Well, was it Biden or was it, you know, Biden? Which
what?
The fake Biden.
I think
rubber suit Biden.
I think the first Biden is the fake Biden and the second Biden is the second
fake
Biden.
See, I don't know
Biden.
About that because sometimes I'm like, that could be fake Biden.
I think there's two fake Bidens.
There could be. There could very well be. Go ahead and play this. This is audio. Yeah, he did care. This was on, this is like what, Friday?
Yeah, Friday.
Yeah,
night.
Listen to this. This is perfect.
I've been over you. I've seen her so late. Secure the economy.
What are you going to do?
And the environment. And a few other small things.
And a few other small things. So he cured the economy and he cured the environment. I'm going to cure your mom. Wait, how do you cure the economy? Is this cured? You know that the meme where it's, is this nature healing? Is this the economy curing? I don't know. That seems really messed up. So she's proud of Bidenomics. They've cured it. Well, then what the hell happened, Joe? It got uncured in the past couple of days. Now it's uncured. Oh, my gosh. This is just so insane. Now, in the meantime, you know, you could have all of this going on. But I don't know. I tried to stay away from politics on the weekends. But I have some persistent friends who absolutely refuse to honor this code. And so I was getting texts over the weekend. Why is Trump going after Kemp in Georgia? I'm like, I don't know. I mean, I was told that he was in the White House ruining the economy. Well, I don't know. I don't know how he's time to do that. If he's, you know, ruining the economy and bringing us to brink of recession, like Kamala Harris said, you know, imagine he's busy not doing things in the office he's not in right now. But he had a rally in Atlanta. I don't know why his campaign needs to stop every other distraction. This economy, and I hate saying it like this, but, you know, I want to win. This economy is the opening door. Absolutely, you need to just hammer. He needs to hammer this home. Every single thing out of his mouth from here in November should be about the economy. Every single thing needs to be about the economy. He needs to stop picking fights with a governor that has 63% approval rating and bested him in votes by 20. Stop. This is completely pointless. I don't understand how he gets so mad at like people like Brian Kemp. And I like that he and J.D. Vance are fine. I don't give a rat's ass. I don't care. But I mean, if you're going to hold a grudge over somebody, I'd hold a grudge over somebody to call me a Nazi more so than I would about somebody who disagreed with me about, you know, Republican policy. Just saying, this needs to stop. I don't want an ego to cost us an election. I want to win. Oh my gosh, I want to tie his hands together. So he can't like be on True Social or he can't add a little note in his speech. Just stop it. Look at this. We are all drowning in an economic disaster. We have, and wait until you hear about this because there's a book out that gets into exactly how much Biden loathes Kamala. We're going to talk about this. We're in such a precarious time. We got to talk about coming up falconry, dead bear, cubs, brain worms, all kinds of nutty stuff. We're going to get into all of that. We also have the latest on polling, veep stakes, so much more you don't want to miss. Celebrate America's founding principles of God-given natural rights, liberty, and limited government with Hillsdale College. And thanks to the team at Hillsdale College, you can watch an inspiring portrayal of Thomas Jefferson reflecting on the Declaration of Independence in a letter that he wrote late in his life. Watch the inspiring video on Thomas Jefferson's letter about the Declaration of Independence written on its 50th anniversary. Amidst the far left's rejection of liberty and equality, let's reaffirm these principles as America's source of greatness, a treasure to preserve. Join me in reminding ourselves and our children and our fellow citizens about the blessings of liberty. Since its founding in 1844, Hillsdale College has stayed true to its mission of providing the education necessary to safeguard principles rooted in the Declaration signed on July 4th. Visit Dana4Hillsdale.com to view this video and receive a free commemorative copy of the Declaration from Hillsdale as our thanks. Keep it or pass it on. Visit Dana4Hillsdale.com. And on behalf of Hillsdale College, let us always treasure America's independence.
All of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
A lousy job report has forced the Fed to reckon with a hard landing. Yeah, we get it. The economy's bad. What is everybody going to do about it instead of just talking about it? I see all these people with their suits and their pantsuits and their suit dresses up at D.C. all twiddling their fingers. What are you all going to do about it? They've been focused on inflation that we were told doesn't exist. So now the Wall Street Journal is like, yeah, well, inflation exists. They've been too busy dealing with inflation. They haven't been worried about the labor market because they've been dealing with inflation. You guys told us inflation wasn't a thing. So which is it? Golly, we need to make assault legal. That's what I'm telling you. I'm there, guys. I'm right there. Who's going to come for my vote on that? Massive New York City fire engulfed 7 homes, 11 firefighters amongst the 14 injured. This is from New York Post. They said that it began at 4 p.m. as a 2-story residence. There was a fire in New York. It's bad. It's sad. I'm sorry that people are injured. 3 civilians. I mean, you got a hurricane that's barreling towards Florida. So you've got fire. You've got a hurricane. Hurricane Debbie. I can't think of that name without thinking of the Adams family. They said that some people lost everything in these fires. It's horrific. Let's see. This aircraft. There's Colorado wildfires. They're using a super scooper aircraft, deploying it to fight these Colorado fires. And these are actually crazy. These are the big giant airplanes that scoop up water and then they fly over and disperse it over the flames. But they said that they're trying to get the fires out as much as possible. This thing can pull 1,400 gallons in 10 seconds. That's crazy. That 1,400 gallons in 10 seconds. And it sounds like they're really quick. Then they drop it, go back, refill, do it over and over again. They said that they've been trying to work overtime to get these fires contained. And let's see here. I need a better headline. JFK Jr. admits that apparently there was a dead bear cub. We're going to talk about this. A dead bear cub incident in Central Park. This story is crazy. We're going to dive into it because I don't know. Like, are people trying to say that this makes... He's not going to win. So why are people acting like this is a campaign-ending event? I don't know. I hate politics. Stick with us. We got more in store. If you haven't had Black Rifle Coffee yet, now is the perfect time to taste why they're becoming one of the most popular coffee companies in America. Black Rifle Coffee Company is veteran-founded, veteran-run, and every purchase you make helps fuel their mission to support veteran and first responder causes. And that includes getting much-needed equipment to first responders, helping vets fight cancer, and so much more. Black Rifle serves a wide variety of ground coffee, whole bean, K-cups, and ready-to-drink coffee for those on the go. Everything from the roast to the bag art pays homage to American culture and military history, and every bag is roasted right here in America. Black Rifle is the go-to in my house, and it keeps me going all day through every broadcast, and you can have Black Rifle Coffee as well. Make sure you visit blackriflecoffee.com, order today, and get 20% off using code DANA. Again, save 20% off using code DANA at blackriflecoffee.com.
This is a Trump country. We live in the Southeast. We drink sweet tea. We don't drink socialist Kool-Aid. Yeah.
Sweet tea. That's a dude at a rally in Atlanta. That's actually hysterical. It is true, because I don't drink sweet tea. I'll just drink regular tea. And if you're ever in the South, in Texas, you're like, oh, I just want some unsweet tea. I swear to you, I don't care how old they are. There's like a beat there. Like, there's something messes up in their head, like a record scratch. So did you say unsweet tea? You want unsweet tea? Then you're viewed as like you're suspicious. Welcome back to the program. Dana Loesch here with you. I don't know if you've seen some of the stuff that's happened. We're going to get to our stuff domestically, but I don't know if you've been seeing some of the things that have been happening like in the UK and in Northern Ireland. This is wild. In the UK, there was, I'm sure you remember, the girls that had been, or the playground that was at, well, it was a kid's birthday party, actually. That was attacked. There was a stabbing attack that took place. And it was a horrific, horrific scenario. There have been riots and protests and all kinds of stuff that have been happening there. And it was weird because, like, in one part of Northern Ireland, weren't there, like, either side standing next to each other in solidarity against some of the stuff? It's just wild what's been happening. They had, one of the places in Middlesbrough, where they were calling them far-right mobs. Are they far-right mobs? I never trust the British press, their characterization of anything. But there were people, because there were apparently, I've seen stuff from the far left going through the streets. There were people from, I guess, that were against that. I mean, there were all kinds of riots. There's been rioting since Friday. There's been rioting in Northern Ireland. There's been rioting in Wales. There's been rioting, interestingly enough, in Rotherham, which you can remember the giant sex grooming scandal where you had British Pakistani grooming gangs targeting very, very young girls for like a decade, over a decade. And the I think the people have had enough of it all. I will say this, you know, in watching some of these headlines with asylum seekers and all of this stuff over the years, it really does feel like the people who live in these areas in and around the UK and even in Northern Ireland, that they feel as though they're underrepresented and really taken for granted. And especially, you know, on the heels of the Rotherham stuff where nobody apparently like did anything, which was just insane to me. That you had something that went on for that long and so many young women were targeted and it just seemed like the government really didn't do anything. People got wrist slaps and, I mean, you know, people are mad because the immigration is out of control and welcoming in boats of asylum seekers. It's like, you know, the same thing. That's how the press describes it. That's, you know, the same thing as like what's been happening at our southern border. And people have been fed up. We've talked about the increase in assaults, the increase in rape and in murder, and women have been targeted. I mean, you had this guy who was the son of Rwandan immigrants who attacked these people at this Taylor Swift-themed dance party. And then people were protesting, and those protests got out of control. There were people who were arrested. They were lighting the trash cans on fire. Riot police were trying to protect the community's mosque from locals who were outraged. And then all across, you know, the UK, there were riots. And I mean, it's tragic to see this because the government created it. The government created this whole issue. And then the government refused to mitigate the problems created by this issue. And then when the people have had enough and they go out into the streets, then they're the ones who are castigated as being the, you know, the source of all the problems. I mean, UK officials, if you're in the UK, if you said, you remember the young girl, she was on the autism spectrum. And remember she had said, wasn't her grandmother like a lesbian or something? And she told this cop that this woman with short hair that she looked like a lesbian because she had short hair like her grandmother. And then the police showed up to arrest the girl. The girl was like 14 years old. They showed up to arrest the girl. So I'm using that as an example of the way that the UK government has gone after you like UK citizens for just the most trivial of offenses. The slightest things, they are raked over the coals over. And then you have people who are coming into their country, some really illegally, and given a pass for it. And then they commit more crimes and they're given a pass for that. And so now people have been saying, well, you have a two-tier justice system in the United Kingdom. You have a two-tiered system here for people who are coming in illegally. You're giving them immediately the benefit of the doubt because you're redefining them as asylum seekers and not everyone's seeking asylum. I mean, it's very similar to what's been happening and how the characterizations are being made at the southern border. So people are done. They're out in the street and they're rioting. And I, quite frankly, don't blame them. And I don't think that anyone else can, you know, either at this point. I mean, this is crazy. This is what complete unchecked policy like this. This is what it creates. And then they're trying to blame the, I mean, I don't know if you've seen, they call them hooligans, but I don't know if you've seen the videos of the actual people protesting. They're young and old. Like there are old ladies out here. I mean, I'm not trying to be mean, but they're like grannies out here protesting. They're done. They're done. Three little girls were killed. They're done. Riot police, you know, they're not able to contain them. When you combine, here's the thing about the United States, and here's the thing about assimilation, and everyone talks about it like it's a bad thing, but when you have completely disparate cultures, when you have complete, you know, cultures with very, very different customs and rules and et cetera, and you're forcing them all together on this tiny little island, and then you're treating one group, you go after them for the most trivial of things, and then very publicly, it looks like those who commit serious crimes, if they fall into a certain demo, get a wrist slap. You are absolutely going to feed tension over this. You know, there's there's an issue here. Like in Germany, when they were bringing in people from Algeria, Northern Africa, different, you know, people who were fleeing, coming across the Mediterranean, going into whether it was Malta or going into Greece, and then being funneled up into the interior of the EU. And remember, this was like 5 or 6 years ago. There were several hundred, and they were all men, several hundred people that they were housing, like at a school in Germany. And there were a lot of security problems that were created, not just for the female volunteers and workers that were taking care of these asylum seekers there, but also for like nearby students and that. And remember, in Germany, they had to pass around a thing teaching dudes how to not rape. I know you all remember this. We talked about it on air. It went viral because they actually had a video of women explaining. They had these like government officials explaining like this is, you know, no unwanted touching and no this, like explaining to them like you would a dog, simple commands. And passing out leaflets and other printed literature so as to teach people, okay, well, you can't, unwanted touching is not acceptable. And, you know, just because a woman is out walking by herself doesn't mean that she is begging for your, you know, aggressive sexual attention, etc. The fact that that even had to be explained is insane. But again, so they're shocked that they're seeing some of this stuff. They're shocked that they're seeing rioting. You're going to continue to see this. And what else are people supposed to do? What else are, I mean, because clearly, and the government, again, is just, you know, it's, of course, it's all, they, you had, who is this guy, their new socialist leader, because the labor took over. I think this was, I dropped this in. This is their new PM over there. I think this, is this their new PM? This is one of the things that I had put in our audio channel. But they had the new prime minister over there who went after, you know, all of the people who were in the streets, said absolutely nothing about the murdered or those who had been attacked. Listen.
Be in no doubt, those that have participated in this violence will face the full force of the law. The police will be making arrests. Individuals will be held on remand. Charges will follow.
This is Keir Starmer. He is the new Prime Minister of Britain.
I guarantee you will regret taking part in this disorder, whether directly or those whipping up this action online and then running away themselves.
This so he's the new Prime Minister of the UK and very, very far left dude. He's with the Labour Party and they're Marxists. I mean, they call them the Labour Party, but they're Marxist. So he's also the guy who's called for like a 11% tax, all this other stuff. Super far left dude. He immediately goes out. I interpret his remarks as adding fuel to the fire. Because he's, you know, these people that are, first off, there was a small group. Again, you have some people are going to be violent, but I'm going to tell you something. When you have the government that continues to look the other way after all of these offenses against, you know, young girls and young women, you're going to get the men on the street kicking ass. That's exactly what's going to happen. And, you know, what are you going to do? The government created this situation and they want to act like they don't, that they didn't do it. They want to act like they haven't. Just like with these economic policies here. I've got a couple of stories. Let me bring it back here domestically. I have a couple of stories, including one, let me pull this up, that gets into a book that was written by some of these, they were with Politico. And it was a book, it was a couple of years ago, and it was written by the dudes who worked in the news bureau at Politico. And the book went into the Biden White House. And it was called This Will Not Pass. It was by Alec Burns and Jonathan Martin. It came out, Simon & Schuster in 22. The book gets into how Kamala Harris's performance, whenever she was like, well, there was one point where she was giving an interview with Lester Holt and she was talking about the border. And when she was asked, well, why didn't you visit the border, by Lester Holt? And it was kind of a softball question, but she fell all over it. And they said apparently the Biden people saw her performance as, quote, strange and disappointing. The book said the exchange dominated American coverage of her visit to Central America. To Biden's staff, it was strange and disappointing turn for the VP. Holt's question had been entirely foreseeable, yet Harris had seemed totally thrown. Had her staff failed to prepare her, or was the vice president just a very uneven performer? And she always said, oh, it was I went down there to see the root causes of what was going on. But they said, apparently, Biden's people thought that she fell short. They thought that she was mismanaging everything. They thought that her Senate office was messy. Her presidential campaign had been a fiasco back in 2020. And they said that this was not the first time in her political career that she had fallen short of sky-high expectations. This is this book that was diving into Biden's real disappointment in Harris. And they said even, and they talk about Ron Klain, who was Biden's White House chief of staff. And Ron Klain apparently was of the position that Kamala Harris didn't do enough on immigration or didn't even show that she was doing anything on immigration. And it said, quote, even Klain understood that something was not working. He told Harris in the fall that she had erred by holding her Latin American assignment at arm's length. Yes, he acknowledged it was a politically delicate portfolio, but there had been an opportunity there for her to take full ownership of something, sink into policy details, and produce results. And they said that the president had known many of her shortcomings when he chose her to be his running mate, but he was viewing questioning of that, of his decision, to be like questioning of his judgment. And he was too egotistical to admit that, oh my gosh, this is a horrible pick for me. He was too egotistical to acknowledge that. So this is interesting that this is, you know, really being pushed now. I keep seeing some of like these references being pushed now on the left. I don't know. It's just very, very odd. But there, we're going to talk here coming up. We got some polling and we got to talk about the Harris honeymoon and what the GOP and Trump are going to have to do, because you have the media all in to make her a thing. And her VP pick is going to, that's going to be a make or break. I've never seen a VP pick so instrumental to a presidential campaign before, but it is with hers. We're going to dive into all of that and more as we roll towards headlines. Americans have had enough of supporting lame companies that hate our values. Are you tired of compromise? Then it's time to switch to Patriot Mobile, America's only Christian conservative wireless provider. They're actually an example of people who make your priorities their priorities, and that's why I'm proud to partner with them. Patriot Mobile offers dependable nationwide coverage, giving you access to all three major networks, which means you get the same coverage that you're accustomed to, but you're not funding the left. And when you switch to Patriot Mobile, you support the First Amendment and the Second Amendment and the sanctity of life and the military and veterans and freedom in general. Their 100% U.S.-based customer service team makes it easy to switch. Keep your number, keep your phone, or upgrade. Their team is going to help you find the best plan for your needs. Just visit patriotmobile.com/Dana or call 972-PATRIOT and get a free month of service when you use offer code Dana. Join me and make the switch today. That's patriotmobile.com/Dana, 972-PATRIOT.
Like sands through the hourglass, so are the days of the United States.
See now is that some want to own the definition of who is a woman. And there I can only invite them to come up with a scientific-based, a new definition of who is a woman and how can somebody being born, raised, competed, and having a passport as a woman cannot be considered a woman. If they are coming up with something, we are ready to listen. We are ready to look into it. But we will not take part in a politically motivated, sometimes politically motivated, cultural war.
Well, it's not a cultural war. It's a very real penalty at the expense of women in competition. Welcome back to the program, Dana Loesch with you. That's the IOC president, Thomas Bach, who's slamming the speech over these boxers because, and the one that he's talking about is the Algerian boxer who they say, oh, well, you know, it's he's actually a, you know, he's a woman. He's got, but XY chromosomes, he's a man. You can be intersex, but here's the thing. The rules in place are to protect women, not the exception. That's why the rules are in place. You know, it's not all of the other women's fault that an individual has a ridiculously insane advantage that actually got them kicked out of other competitions. XY chromosomes dictate male or female. So you can have some, and we don't even know, that's just taking their word for it, by the way. Nobody actually knows. It's just that it's what they say, and so you're supposed to take their word for it, which I don't. And I don't think that anybody would disagree with me on that. You had the one from the fighter from Algeria, and then you have the fighter who was from Taiwan. And this, who was also apparently a male, both in the boxing program. And of course, they both, aren't they supposed to fight each other? Something like that? We're going to talk more about this coming up because, when you know, these rules are in place to protect women, not for the exception. And I think it's hate speech to suggest otherwise. Stick with us. Second hour on the way. In these times of unrest and uncertainty, it's crucial to secure life's basic essentials like food. ReadyWise offers reliable, high-quality food supplies for emergencies or everyday peace of mind. Trust ReadyWise to keep your pantry stocked. And with ReadyWise emergency food, you're covered, not just for the worst, but for anything that life throws your way. It's like an insurance policy, knowing that you have delicious, nutritious meals ready for when your family needs them. ReadyWise has a huge selection of freeze-dried meals from breakfast to pasta dishes, and you can be assured that your food will be good to eat when you need it with their 25-year shelf life. ReadyWise is an American company that cares about its fellow citizens, including you, and they want every American family to be prepared for any situation. With ReadyWise, you can trust that your family will have the essentials to weather any storm. Visit ReadyWise.com and use promo code Dana20 at checkout for 20% off of any regularly priced item. That's ReadyWise.com, promo code Dana20 for 20% off.
It is wrong to somehow suggest that an undocumented immigrant is a criminal.
Being an undocumented immigrant is not a crime.
I know what a crime looks like.
An undocumented immigrant is not a criminal.
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 An undocumented immigrant is not a criminal, and we have to correct course in this conversation.
We're not going to treat people who are undocumented across the borders.
Oh my gosh. And you know what? A person with an undocumented purchase from a store isn't a thief either. You know, drug dealers are just undocumented pharmacists. Let's be real. Welcome back to the program. Dana Loesch here with you. The top of the second hour on a Monday, getting you set up for the day. And make sure you go find us over at Substack, Chapter and Verse. A lot of good stuff up there as well. So this is some flashback stuff that's coming out about her now. Well, we've all known this, but do you realize how many times she said this? I thought that unburdened by what has been was the big thing. But no, it's maybe this. An undocumented immigrant is not a criminal. So, like I said, a person with an undocumented purchase from a store isn't a thief. Drug dealers are just unlicensed pharmacists, undocumented pharmacists. Then that means I can get, you know, an NFA item and just have an undocumented NFA item. That's not a crime, right? I mean, hell, I'm all for going with this. Oh, let's do this. Please. Please. Some of us work really, really hard to live our lives by the good book, but let's be honest, some of us walk the line because there are laws that say you have to. And I'm just saying, don't be bending those rules for those people. Don't. So this, a lot of stuff to hit because everything's popping off. Kane and I, what did you say to me at the start of the show about Lockheed?
Oh, yeah. Over the past month, we've seen an increase on Lockheed Martin's stock price, while we just recently saw the entire market, NASDAQ, Dow, the rest of it, taking a nice 10% haircut. So when the defense contractors seem to be making all the money and the regular market seems to be selling off, It usually means there's conflict happening worldwide.
A little bit. A little bit.
Yeah.
So I was looking at this, a couple of headlines out about this. Like, we're sending, what, increasing our show of force in the Middle East. We've deployed some ships and fighter jets. And I think that's a lot more so with regards to Israel and Iran. We've got, what, there's some more war. Stars and Stripes said that they're sending more warships and additional fighter squadron out there.
I mean, just add that to the hundreds of billions we've been giving Ukraine over the past
couple
years.
Well, no, this is us sending our stuff out there.
Right.
I mean, we're not giving this. This is just us, you know, going out there. And Iran's leaders had vowed to retaliate. They said that they were going to retaliate against Israel, hitting back at them after they had funded all the people attacking Israel all this whole time. That's really the... Jimmy Carter's responsible for all of that in Iran. He is responsible for every bit of it, and everybody should remember that. So, Iran, apparently, there were some efforts over the past few days for Iran to temper its response after Hamas's political leader got murked, and they were looking at the security breaches that led to all of this. But they apparently, it's not, you know, the Iranian leaders, they vowed to retaliate. They keep saying they're going to retaliate. This has been Israel did not just decide that they were going to just kick off rockets and target Iran randomly. Let's revisit again what led to this. Hezbollah carried out numerous strikes, and they Golan Heights, you had a bunch of Israeli children playing on a soccer field that were killed. The rockets showed they were absolutely, without any debate, provided by Iran. That's it. Now, they just launched off strikes that killed innocents. Israel launched two precision hits. These strikes, remember what I was telling you about on Friday? One of the strikes only literally detonated in one room, in one building, and it didn't even bother the room of the other terrorist that was next door. Way big difference. And so this idea, I mean, you've got Iran funding northern and southern attacks with Hamas and Hezbollah. So this is not just something that they decided to do, again, randomly. They are not the aggressor here. They're defending themselves. But any attempt that Israel makes to defend itself is always described by the people who attack them as, oh, well, they're the aggressor. So now we're sending warships and additional fighter squadron to the Middle East to bolster our defenses and kind of, you know, show that, well, I guess, you know, we got a presence here. Lloyd Austin ordered Navy destroyers and cruisers to bolster protection and increase our readiness to deploy any kind of additional land-based ballistic missile defense. And it's a USS Abraham Lincoln aircraft carrier strike group. The whole strike group's being moved to the Middle East to maintain a carrier strike group presence. That's going to replace, because the USS Theodore Roosevelt's the strike group that's out there right now. It's coming towards the end of its deployment. So the USS Abraham Lincoln's replacing the Roosevelt carrier strike group. And so we're bolstering a little bit. We're not sending like two groups. One group's coming back. And so, we've had a consistent warship presence there. And now we're going to have additional ballistic missile defense capable cruisers. And this is what Biden had said in a call to Netanyahu, that there would be new military deployments to protect against possible attacks from ballistic missiles, etc. They don't want to escalate. I mean, clearly there are some people, at least in D.C., that are worried about escalation. But if they were to stop attacking, this would be over. They don't want to stop attacking, thus it's not over. I mean, there's no more simple way to put it. But while all this is happening, the economy worldwide is getting just beaten to death. Here in the U.S., people are finally acknowledging that, I mean, we are in a recession. This is not, well, are we in a recession? Are we going to go into a recession? We are in a recession. The end. And in an election cycle where the Republican Party needs to focus entirely on the economy, hit the things that you're good at. Oh my gosh, I'm just about, look, if Republicans lose this, if Republicans lose in November, it will be because they lost it themselves. There are too many things at stake here. Now, some of the polling, I mean, she's kind of had, after switching out from Biden to Harris, there's been a bit of a Kamala honeymoon, sort of, but it's kind of short-lived. Did you guys see some of the stuff that was over the weekend real quick related to Harris? So her husband, Doug Emhoff, admits he cheated with a nanny on his first wife. He got his nanny pregnant. He slept around on his wife with his nanny. His nanny got pregnant. This was like 15 years ago. His daughter was 10. And it was with the nanny for their older kids. Apparently, she did not keep the baby, but nobody knows what that means, per the Washington Times. He released a statement immediately after CNN reported it. He said, quote, during my first marriage, Kirsten and I went through some tough times on account of my actions. I took responsibility in the years since. You know, we worked through things as a family. We've come out on the other side, et cetera. I mean, that tracks, doesn't it, Kane? Mm-hmm. You know, it tracks. That tracks. So I don't think that that's going to matter at all to Democrat voters. It's weird that it came out from CNN, but I don't think it's going to matter at all with them. I really don't. A couple of things to be aware of, too, as it relates to some of the polling. I mean, it's still close, and she's got to pick her VP. A lot of people were saying that, well, you know, Veep stakes, it looks like it, you know, I think it's going to be, and I think her smartest pick would be Josh Shapiro. John Fetterman, though, has concerns. He apparently, according to Politico, told Harris's team that he thought that Shapiro was more about his own personal ambition than for the nation. Aren't most of these people in politics like that? I can't tell you the number of people that I meet who are like, yes, I'm all about for the country. And it's about themselves. It's about themselves. They'll make a pack and then they'll take a check off it. You know, they'll create a group and they'll cash a check off it. You know, and it's off advocacy. They pay themselves and then they do this advocacy and then they end up not really actually moving the needle a whole hell of a lot. I don't know. It's like it's the nature of the game. That's why, you know, it stuck out to me a little bit that Fetterman is accusing Josh Shapiro of excessively focusing, per Politico, on his own personal ambitions. Now, some of this comes down to apparently like a rivalry between them. Shapiro and Fetterman don't get along, have never really gotten along. So maybe that, you know, I don't know. Maybe that's why it's coming into play. Are any of them good, though? Do you think any of them? Is there a single VP pick that she can make that does not have personal ambition? Come on. I don't think so. So Mark Kelly was one of them. And apparently over the weekend, there were a lot of people accidentally posting stuff over the weekend. And he was one of them. He posted a tweet that he later deleted. It said, my background is a bit different than most politicians. And he's like, you know, my mission now is serving Arizonans. He posted a tweet and he deleted it. And it sounded like MSNBC reported on it. And they said, oh, he deleted his post. And it said it sounded like he was no longer in the running mate race. Because he had said, you know, I spent my life serving at NASA and the Navy. Mission is always first. Now my mission is serving Arizonans. Well, that's kind of a tweet that you would make if you're not running for VP, right? And so people were saying, oh my gosh, I guess he took himself out of the race. Well, then he tweeted, quote, whether it was from my time in the Navy at NASA, serving in the Senate, visiting troops overseas, I've learned that when your country asks you to serve, you always answer the call. So now, like, people are wondering, okay, he deleted the first one. Is this now, I mean, it's not your country asking you to call. It's a very flawed, ridiculous candidate that's asking you to be the landmine on her ticket. So let's not, like, make it into something that it's not. I don't know. It's interesting. I think Mark Kelly would be a bad pick. He's got a lot of baggage, and he's a senator. I think you're going to have a governor with somebody like her. We're going to talk about this more as we roll towards headlines. Turbocharging your metabolism has never been simpler thanks to the innovative handheld metabolic coach Lumen. This revolutionary device empowers you to optimize your metabolism efficiently and effortlessly. And with Lumen, you can master the strategies to keep your metabolism humming at its best. Now, Lumen is a breath-based metabolic tracker. You breathe into the Lumen at the start of your day to get a metabolism snapshot and a personalized nutrition plan. And then the app tells you if you're burning fat or carbs. You can get customized tips for nutrition, workouts, sleep, stress. Lumen helps you to know with real data what your body needs. Now, your metabolism is your body's rocket engine. It powers everything that you do. And with Lumen, you can expect easier weight management, balanced energy, fitness gains, and find it easier to go to sleep. So if you want to take the next step in improving your health, visit lumen.me/DanaShow and get 15% off of your Lumen. That's lumen.me/DanaShow. One word for 15% off your purchase. That's lumen.me/DanaShow. And thanks to Lumen for sponsoring this episode.
It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
I'm like also cool if we just want to karaoke some Outkast. You know, Big Boy follows me on Twitter, and I think it's the gun stuff, but I'm just saying. All right, so apparently there's a new anti-aging drug that could increase your lifespan. And all the celebrities are taking it. Great. All the annoying people are going to live longer and be more annoying longer. Yay. They said that it's everything. I'm so tired of the phrase holy grail. Not everything is a holy grail. You can't even go on Sephora and look at reviews of stuff because you have stupid brain dead, miles wide, inches deep, shallow ass influencers who are like, oh my gosh, this is my holy grail product. No, it's not. So anyway, it's called NAD. Of course it is. It's a molecule that's produced naturally in the body. It's sold in pill, liquid, and IV form. And everybody from like the Bebbers, the Joe Rogan, the Kardashians are all doing it. And they say it helps you feel energized, youthful, and healthy. Why does this sound like an ad? An ad for NAD. It's a NAD ad. NAD ad. Vatican broke silence on the controversial Paris Olympics. Oh, they did finally now, huh? Good for them. Look at that. They finally said something. A week later. 1 week later. Vatican broke their silence on the Last Supper drag performance. The Pope apparently said that the Holy See was saddened by certain scenes at the opening of the Paris Olympic Games. And Canapa joined the voices raised in recent days to deplore the offense done to many Christians and believers of other religions. Again, it's that Chonky Smurf, man. It's Chonky Smurf. We had a whole thing about this. So apparently from vacations to so-so jobs, now MS the media saying it's time to embrace being average. This is the most anti-American thing I've ever read in my life. They call it embrace the joy of being average. What? Now, oh no, but Dana, this sounds like a do-gooder, feel-good story, right? Because it talks about this person's totally anecdotal friend of hers. And they're working like a four-day work week and blah, blah, blah. And like, you know, she's the laws of capitalism say we have to be on the move, work hard, play hard, rinse, repeat. And we're supposed to be the best and smartest out there. But maybe like being average is good. No. This is Marxist tripe that wants to lull you in to a sense of mediocrity. And so then they're going to backpat you and tell you that it's totally fine to be mediocre. But no, that's not for you. This sounds like a Seuss book now, but it's not. This country was made because we were above average. And that's one thing that Americans have that unites us all. I don't care where you come from. Everybody wants to be above average. And everyone knows that you're an American. No matter what you look like or where you came from, you're an American when you want to be above average. So I'm just saying, this like the tiny house thing, is some Marxist tripe. It's a Marxist psyop. All the fingers, double barrel fingers for being average. No, we're not doing that. I want to come back to this. All right, so officials monitoring a dead whale. Oh, really? I mean, nothing else is happening today. Off the coast of southern Maine, there's a dead whale. I think I saw this in the opening ceremony of the Olympics at the table. It's a dead humpback whale. Off of Wells, it's the third dead whale that's been found off the coast of southern Maine in the past 2 months. It was floating 2 miles off the coast. Very important. It's apparently an adult female that was named Lollipop Kane. Lollipop the dead humpback whale. And what do you do with it? It's a dead whale that's floating 2 miles. Why do you get a boat out there and watch it?
Don't blow it up.
Is there a reason why you got a boat out there and watch it? It's a dead whale, right? Like, I don't. Is there something I'm missing? Stick with us. We got a lot more in store. As Americans, we owe immense gratitude to the brave military men and women who sacrificed their safety and lives to protect our freedom. Did you know that you can also show your support for our military veterans and first responders simply by using your cell phone with Patriot Mobile? When you switch to Patriot Mobile, you not only get reliable coverage, but you're also supporting Folds of Honor, Tunnel to Towers, Boots for Warriors, Helping a Hero, Warrior Rising, and many other worthy causes. And you can feel confident that your cell provider stands with you in defending cherished principles. Switch today and enjoy the benefits of seamless service from a 100% U.S.-based customer support team, making the switch effortless. Keep your current number and phone or upgrade. The choice is yours. Let Patriot Mobile find you the perfect plan that fits all of your preferences. Just visit patriotmobile.com/Dana or call 972-PATRIOT and get a free month of service when you use offer code Dana. So join me and make the switch today. That's patriotmobile.com/Dana or call 972-PATRIOT.
I was taking a group of people falconing up in Goshen, New York, up in the Hudson Valley, and I was supposed to meet them there at like maybe 8 or 9. I was driving up maybe, you know, really early, like 7, and that woman in a van in front of me hit a bear and killed it, a young bear. So I pulled over and I picked up the bear and put him in the back of my van because I was going to skin the bear, and it was very good condition, and I was going to and put the meat in my refrigerator. And you can do that in New York City. You can get a bear tag for a roadkill bear. And so then we went hawking, and I had the bear in my car, and then we had a really good day, and we went late. We were catching a lot of game, and the people really loved it, so we stayed late. And instead of going back to my home in Westchester, I had to go right to the city because there was a dinner at Peter Luger's Steakhouse. And at the end of the dinner, it went late, and I realized I couldn't go home. I had to go to the airport. And the bear was in my car, and I didn't want to leave the bear in the car, because that would have been bad. So then I thought, you know, at that time, this was a little bit of the redneck in me. There'd been a series of bicycle accidents in New York. They had just put in the bike lanes. And a couple of people got killed, and it was every day, and people had gotten badly injured. Every day it was in the press. Yeah. And so I thought, I wasn't drinking, of course, but people were drinking with me who thought this was a good idea. And I said, I had an old bike in my car that somebody had asked me to get rid of it. I said, let's go put the bear in Central Park and we'll make it look like he got hit by a bike.
Oh my gosh. So, this is why you should never go falconing. Guys, it's a Kennedy saying that he's a redneck. I am spent. I am spent. Welcome back to the program. Dana Loesch with you. Where the hell are we? Second hour. Are we on Mars? What time? Good night. It's back with you here. Dana Loesch with you. Bottom of this second hour. So that was So apparently RFK Jr., a story was, I'm trying to get you to understand the chain of events for this. There was a story, somebody found out that he was with a bear in Central Park, and they were going to come out with a story about him being with a bear in Central Park. So he decided to get ahead of the story, Kane. Is that how this went? And then he told it like this, and then that's why?
Yep.
Did he go falconing?
I have no reason to disbelieve him.
This is like a cutscene from The Royal Tenenbaums. You know, and the redneck in me. Oh my gosh, you're a Kennedy. Stop it. Oh my gosh. What is that? Oh my gosh, I can't. I know some of you like him. I don't care. I'm just laughing at the craziness of this whole situation. So it's a weird thing. I mean, and the story, okay, this is where it gets crazier. So the reporter with the New York Times, who is coming out with a story, was his own cousin. It's JFK's daughter's daughter. So Caroline Kennedy's daughter, apparently, because they all work in the press or run for office, that's all they can do. So I don't know. She said that she had no idea our own family was involved in the story. You had no idea that RFK Jr. was your cousin and he was involved in this. What? Okay, sure. But how random is it? I mean, if you told me, Dana, I want you to come up with a scenario that involves Roseanne Barr and JFK falconing a dead bear cub, the Luger Steakhouse, I don't think I could. I don't think I could do that. That sounded like a Mad Lib thing. They were playing Mad Libs. I don't know how else to say it. So he was going to a, and nobody in the media knows how to talk about falconry outings. What in the blue blood hell is that? Kane, would you like to pass some Grey Poupon while we go on our falconry outing? But he was like, oh, I was going to skin the bear and put the meat in my freezer. Do you really believe that he wanted the meat or did he want a bear rug? I'm just saying. But it showed, like, there's a picture of him with it. Like, he's got a picture and it shows it's this little bear and he's pretending that it's biting him. And is that where the brain worm came from?
It's quite possible. But I was thinking, like, let's look at the worst possible version of this story.
Is there a worst possible version? I just think it's weird. I'm not making fun of, I'm not saying it's worse, bad, or good. I just think it is hysterically bizarre. I am endlessly entertained by this story. Kane, it is literally a Mad Libs exercise.
Yeah.
Like, again, like the whole Zoomer thing with TikTok. It's market crash and a dead bear cub. Market crash and a dead bear cub.
But
market crash and a dead bear cub. That's a new cycle.
I just don't understand, like, even the worst part of the story. Let's just take everything that RFK Jr. said at face value, and that's 100% true. So what?
I love it how he goes, because the New Yorker was going to break the story, apparently. And he put it out going, looking forward to seeing how you spin this one, New Yorker. And the New Yorker was probably like, what in the world?
The story worse than what we reported it as.
I don't care. I mean, it happened, you know, right. This broad hit a bear with her car. I mean, you know, it happens. You can get, I think it's weird that you have to go ask the state, can I have this dead animal? Can I pay a tax and get a tax for this dead animal? Can I do that? I mean, it's dead. It was on, you know, I guess maybe they don't want people randomly hitting animals and being like, you know, finders keepers, you know, dibs. I don't know.
It's the redneck in them.
Yeah, I operate on the dibs system. True, though.
Dibs!
Uh-oh, somebody hit a bear. Robert Kennedy emerges from the woods. I'm a redneck. Dibs! Yeah, there we are. And scene. So, yeah, falconry. That's why you shouldn't do it. When he was asked about the incident, he literally said, quote, maybe that's where I got my brain worm.
I was just joking off air about that. Seriously?
You know, when I hear brainworm, I think of that, the Corpse Bride, Tim Burton's The Corpse Bride, and that little worm that has a Spanish accent that comes out. I'm like, why does the worm have a Spanish accent and you don't? Like, it's weird. Okay, anyway. So, yeah, dead bear cubs, falconry, drugs, cyclists. This is like a... did not have this on my bingo card at all. None of this.
Glad he didn't choose to just blow up the bear.
Yeah, so that's it. Can I do one more quick little aside, and then will you guys bear with me for a moment? And then we're going to get back to meat and potatoes, because the news cycle is so horrific. We got to clear our palate. I make fun, so much fun, of people who try to, like, ruin the English language. Like, instead of saying converse, they'll say conversate, which is not a word. Right? I just can't deal with it. So I realized, are we the baddies? Are we? And here's why. Let me, and as a hat tip to RFK's crazy conversation, Kane found a video that I'd never seen before of somebody blowing up a dead whale. I don't know where this is going. And I wanted to point out that their logic about not wanting to have a giant rotting whale carcass on the beach for animals to scavenge at, was it made better by blowing it up into millions of pieces that animals could scavenge? It's a lesson. In a 14-mile area.
It's a lesson only hindsight can teach.
Okay, apparently. But there was one part of the video that froze me in my tracks. And it's like just a couple seconds. Juan, I think you have this ready to go. Just one part of the video. It just stopped me right in my tracks as it pertained to language. Just listen real quick.
Confident that it'll work. The only thing is we're not sure just exactly how much explosives it'll take to disintegrate this thing. So the scavengers,
this is way early. We need to go way back. I think I actually have it.
About 75 bystanders.
All right, yeah, get it. Just play. It's only like 6 seconds. Just go ahead.
An object of curiosity before they tired of its smell.
And then Kane, do yours.
Situation suddenly gave way to a run for survival as huge chunks of whale blubber fell everywhere. Pieces of meat passed high over our heads while others were falling at our feet.
It's, I have it here. It's basically where he says,
our camera stopped rolling immediately.
Okay, well, hell's bells. I thought you guys had this. You guys were playing it like right after each other and it was perfect. The guy says whale at one point. Whale. And I'm like, wait, what? Because he said, it was at the end of the video, whale.
The passenger compartment literally smashed. Fortunately, no human was hit as badly as the car. However, everyone on the scene was covered with small particles of dead whale.
Whale. Okay, I'm watching this whole video, and I stop on my tracks at whale. Because I'm like, what in the world have we been saying, if not whale? We've been saying whale, right? Like
right.
Dead whale.
Right. Like
whale, whaling, whalers, whales.
Yeah,
I don't
like
know.
W-A-I-L.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Whale. Like one would say wheat.
Cool. Whip.
Whip. Cool. Oh my gosh, Kane, we have been.
We've been saying it wrong.
We've been murdering the English language. We've not been saying. Whew. So I'm going to over enunciate the hell out of all WH from now on. Like whore.
Well, who would want that?
Who would want that? Whale. So I just, I don't know, that fascinated me. It's the little things in life, guys. Come on, the economy is circling the, you know what, we're sending more stuff over to the Middle East. We got a crazy election cycle, and Harris is going to get a bump because she's going to pick a VP. Let me have this moment. And my glasses are weird today. All right, so this is what we got on deck. We got Florida Man on the way, but also... Also, we've got a few other things because I do have polling to dive into. Georgia, Arizona. Arizona's a battleground. We're going to have this conversation. We got to talk about Arizona. We're also going to get into some more bread, maybe one little aspect of Bread and Circus 2024, because I'm hearing from all of you that you were not even watching it. So we're going to touch on that. The debate. So Kamala Harris now says she won't debate, but this was after she threw down the gauntlet and dared Trump to debate. Wait, what? So she... What? We're going to discuss this. So we've got all of this and a lot more. Also, latest with the economy and 2024 and everything else. So we got a lot still on deck, and Stephen Yates is going to be joining us. Thanks for watching The Dana Show. Make sure to like, subscribe, ring the bell, and stay tuned for more content.